Everybody knows that resistance can be measured for things by setting up a circuit in which you know, let's see, what do you need to know? Well, you probably need to be running a current through the thing, and the thing that we want to measure is this resistor right here, right? And we're probably going to need to know how much current we've got going through it, and we're also going to need to know the voltage drop across it, right? So the voltage drop then could be measured as the voltage of the battery, right? And we could really quickly throw up some truth like V is IR. Sure, and that would give us the resistance. The resistance of this thing then has to be V over I. And that's great as long as the resistance is large, then there won't be much current. But if there's a lot of current, then you're going to have a voltage drop. That maybe that's not really the problem. The problem is that if this resistance is small, which would cause a lot of current, right? So that's kind of how I got it, that misstatement. But I guess my point is, if this resistance is small, if it's at all comparable to the resistance of this wire, which in principle is not ideal, and this wire right here, which in principle is ideal, but you know, really isn't, and this wire up here isn't, and then you've got, oh, internal resistance of the battery, so, oh, gross. And then, like, the ammeter, of course, has zero resistance, except if it's a real ammeter, then it has to have a little bit of resistance, because it's actually measuring the current by measuring the voltage across a small internal resistance, right? Unless it's, like, Hall effect or something. But even so, they still have a tiny bit of resistance, right? They do their best, but do you have a superconducting Hall effect ammeter on your bench? I don't. Okay, so here's my point. If this is a small resistance, then we need to do better than just V battery. We need to get ourselves a voltmeter and stick it right here. And that becomes then, really what that becomes is a 4-point resistance measurement. You can't just measure the voltage and the current with the same contacts to the thing. So I'm thinking of two labs that I do with my class in which this is necessary. One of them is actually a resistive wire that's taped to a meter stick. Mine are not bolted onto the meter stick, but traditionally it's just taped onto both sides right here, and it's a nichrome wire or something, and you've got yourself a battery, and it goes woo, and it just, you know, you just get some electric field set up in the wire, and you can measure all this stuff, and you take this voltmeter, and you go bloop, and you're supposed to measure the voltage difference between these two locations, and you move these leads from place to place, and you make this wonderful graph. What are you graphing? Probably separation. You realize that separation is what's important because you do this experiment, then you do this one, this one, this one, and you kind of get the same result the whole time. And then you go a little bit wider and notice that the voltage is even bigger, so you get this graph right there. And then the slope of that is probably the electric field, right? Because that's the only thing that's not changing in that experiment, where you're changing where you're located and how far apart you're located, but you're not changing the battery and you're not changing how much of this wire is getting the current going through it. So that's the important thing with a 4-point resistance measurement, that current is going to be consistent because you only have one path, assuming you've got a good voltmeter, right? But you've only got one path for the current to flow. So the current could be measured anywhere, and you need to get as close as possible to the sample with your voltmeter. Now, the nice thing is you're not going to have a big current through your voltmeter, because as we've already discussed, this is really useful for a very, very conductive thing. So your voltmeter is very, very high impedance. It's like got a lot of resistance built into it. So your voltmeter is not going to impact your measurement very much. It's not going to increase the current that would be coming through here, which if it were a low resistance voltmeter connecting it in parallel with a bit of your testing material, it would impact it. So here's another lab in which we use a 4-point resistance measurement. We make this conductive goo. It's like Play-Doh, but when you make it from the, oh, I should recommend Squishy Circuits. It's a college wear. Oh, well, anyway, you'll find out when you look up Squishy Circuits, because Squishy Circuits has some great a recipe actually for making this stuff, and you can make it very conductive or very insulating. But I like to make the reasonably conductive stuff, and then I ask my students to roll it into cylinders of various shapes. And we've found that they have to be at least of a certain length to get any significant resistance, any measurable resistance. But even so, if you try to do a measurement, like here's my problem. My problem is my students usually come in with some voltage source. I need my own page for this. All right, but here's the glob of the squishy circuits material, an almost Play-Doh kind of thing. And you get yourself a battery and you hook it up and maybe you put a bent paper clip in here that's just like shoved into there. And then of course you got an ammeter and you plug it in to right there. And then you go into another bent paper clip. You just grab this with a clippy or something and measure right there. Now, if you come over to this sucker with your voltmeter and you attach, can't be brown, gonna have to be violet purple. You take your voltmeter and you clip it on to here and to here, then you're going to be measuring not only the resistance of the dough, which we're trying to get to the resistivity usually, and probably that has something to do with the amount of the material. So as you change this radius right here, and as you change the length between those two, then that allows you to get at like the essential, like what is the resistivity of some bulk of this material. That's neat, right? I think it's neat. Anyway, a property of the material rather than a property of the thing that's made from the material. Like shear versus the spring constant, you know? The shear constant is the essential characteristic of it. Get me some Young's modulus, some bulk modulus. Let's get to like materials rather than things that are made with materials. Leave those for the engineers to work on. So the problem is, you're going to get resistance from the point where your clippy grabs onto this other clippy or onto the paper clip, and you're gonna get resistance for this place where this paper clip is inside the Play-Doh. And I'll tell you what, if you're pumping a significant current through here, and you're probably going to just because you're an enthusiastic high school student, then you're probably actually boiling some of the water that was used in making this dough away from here. So it's gonna start smoking. And that's gonna change right around here. It's gonna dry up a little bit. And maybe this one is gonna turn a funny color. Maybe you're pumping some ions one direction or another. And maybe some of the ions are grabbed onto some of the food coloring that you put in there. I mean, it's a really interesting lab. But the issue is you don't want those resistances. You wanna get the resistance of the material itself. So you say to that multimeter, come on, narrow it in a little bit. Let's never mind all this stuff. Let's go this way and go in here to our own bent paperclip. I guess in this world, paperclips are green, right? We'll just go into there and we'll go into another paperclip that we put over here. Now we wanna be far enough into this squishy circuit material that we believe that the current that's going from here to here has spread out, you know, it's gonna come from this point source and kind of spread out across the bulk of it and then go through here, and it will narrow back down when it gets to this one. So let's choke up a little bit, but we wanna be as far as possible also because we want as much resistance as we can get so that we can measure it more accurately. And then we'll do the same thing over here and not grab onto there, we'll grab onto right here. Now, the beauty of this is twofold. One, we don't have the resistance of clipping onto here, and we don't have the resistance of clipping onto here, and anything funny that's going on right there is going on there, yes, but all it's doing is decreasing the current. But who cares if the current has any particular value? All we need to know is what it is at an instant when we measure the voltage drop between these two locations. You see what I'm saying? The current value is not important compared to other current values, or like before it starts melting or after it's been melting or something. What we're doing is we're setting up an electric field inside of here, and we're measuring the potential difference inside that electric field in two spacings. And you know that that's the good stuff. If you get yourself an electric field, in this case, be going this direction, right? You can measure that electric field by measuring the voltage of a certain equipotential and another equipotential. So that was my discussion about how to put them in a little bit. We do know that, I guess if you're viewing this from the top, that those field lines will be coming out from that probe. And this is a top view. And then they're gonna be coming back down into the other paperclip probe. But you can look at those equipotentials, and in the middle, we're gonna be happy to say that the equipotentials are equally spaced. and parallel, and so that's nice. So like you could put a probe right here and a probe right here, and you could actually get at the value of the resistance of the material. So anytime you are measuring the resistance of something that has very little resistance, you must use the four probe resistance measurement. It's also called Kelvin measurement, and Wikipedia calls it a four terminal, what does it call it? I was just looking at Wikipedia just a second ago. Oh, four terminal sensing. Now isn't that nice? All right, so now you know about it and you should also do it. I'm also thinking about when I was regulating some experiments, regulating the temperature of some experiments, there was a little thermal resistor down at the bottom of a very, very long thing. And the thermal resistor just, I mean, it just has some thermal dependence on its resistance. So you need to know it really accurately. But I was always confused, you know, just as a kid, why there were four wires going into there. And that's because they wanted to not have the resistance of the purple wires, which were providing the current, in the calculation of, in the calculation of the resistance of the resistor down there. So it isolates the particular, just where you decide to attach your voltmeter isolates the area of interest more carefully. That's it.